Morning, Nuho Volcano.
Good morning.
Good morning. Hallelujah. Another beautiful day the Lord has made.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So as most of you know, we like to open up with a bit of the word and some prayer before we begin worship. You know, it was put on my heart this morning. One of the verses that always stand out to me is John chapter 3 and verse 30. And that's where John the Baptist is saying to his followers that they came to him and said, hey, Jesus, this guy named Jesus is baptizing people and he's got many followers. And John the Baptist says, that's exactly right. He must become greater and I must become less.
Thank you, Lord.
And then I open up my Bible app this morning and it says 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 6, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God and he will lift you up in due time. And so it's been on my heart this morning that we just humble ourselves before the Lord and just let him have his way with us this morning. Amen. So let's bow our heads and open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. We thank you for the gift of life, Lord, that we can wake up. We can come here and gather in your name with our brothers and sisters, the body of Christ, that we can love on each other. We can fellowship with one another. It is so amazing to see our brothers and sisters who sometimes we don't get to see for a whole week. But when we come on Sunday, we know that we can be lifted up and we can lift one another up. And we're so thankful for that blessing that you give us to be a part of this body of Christ. Father, we want to humble ourselves right now. We want to get out of the way, and we just want to have you come and fill us up today. Fill our cups, Father, to overflowing this morning as we worship you, as we put you first, as we lift our voices to you, Lord. We love you so much. We give you all of the glory, the honor, and the praise, and we pray in your Son Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
And
amen.
Thank you, Pastor Jason.
Oh, heaven, we pray. The beauty of the risen Lord.
Hallelujah.
Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever he will be.
Forever he will be.
The Lamb upon the throne.
The Lamb upon the throne.
I gladly bow my knee.
I gladly bow my knee
and worship you alone. All heaven declares
the beauty of the risen Lord.
Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever he will be.
Forever he will be.
The Lamb upon the throne.
The Lamb upon the throne.
I gladly bow my knee.
I gladly bow my knee.
And worship you alone. Gladly bow my knee.
I gladly bow my knee and worship you alone.
Thank you, Lord. Worship.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
A savior wretch like me.
I once was lost, but now am found.
Blind, but now I see. God is so good.
God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. Oh, 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 oh. Heaven is in my heart.
That's right.
Oh, 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 oh. Heaven is in my heart. Oh, 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 oh. Heaven is in my heart. Oh, 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 heaven is in my heart.
The kingdom of our God is here.
Heaven is in my heart.
The presence of his majesty. Heaven is in my heart. And in his presence joy abound. Heaven is in my heart. The light of holiness surrounds. Heaven is in my heart.
Oh, 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 oh. Heaven is in my heart. Oh, 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 oh. Heaven is in my heart. Oh, 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 oh. Heaven is in my heart. Oh, 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 oh. Heaven is in my heart.
We are the temple of his throne.
Heaven is in my heart.
And Christ is our foundation stone.
Heaven is in my heart.
He will return to take us home.
Heaven is in my heart.
The Spirit and the Bride say come.
Heaven is in my heart. Oh, 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 oh. Heaven is in my heart.
Heaven is in my heart. Heaven is in my heart. There is joy in the Lord.
There is light in his spirit. There is hope in the knowledge of him.
There's a fountain that flows like a river from heaven,
abounding in love
to my soul.
All blessings and honor are his. All glory and power are his. Let all wisdom and strength be the Lord's in this place. Let all glory be given to him.
There is joy in the Lord.
There is love in his spirit. There is hope in the knowledge of him.
There's a fountain I know.
Every time I am near it, my heart overflows to the Lord. All blessing and honor are his. All glory and power are his.
Let all wisdom and strength be the Lord's in this place.
Let all glory be given to him.
Now sing, shout, clap your hands
and praise unto your maker. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
Sing, shout, clap your hands
with praise unto the Maker. For the Lord, he is almighty
God. Sing, shout,
clap your hands with praise unto the Maker. Bring the joyful noise unto the Lord.
Sing and shout and clap your hands, give praise unto your Maker, for the Lord, he is Almighty God.
This is a day of celebration.
This is a day to rejoice.
Rejoice!
The Lord our
reach out, clap your hands,
we praise unto the Maker. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
Sing, shout, clap your hands,
give praise unto your Maker.
For the Lord is Almighty
God.
For the Lord is Almighty God. For the Lord is Almighty God. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save.
It's the gospel, sing it now.
You came from heaven to show the way from the earth to the cross. My destiny from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. From heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my destiny, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Oh, Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We thank you so much.
Bless
for just a place to gather and just worship you, Father God. We thank you so much. We remember every single thing that you do for us, Father. And we just ask that you bless this service. Bless every person that's here and online, Father God. Bless those that are still on their way. But most of all, Father God, we just love you and we lift you up, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Amen, and amen. I don't know if you've had this experience. Maybe I think some of you have. We have many times had experiences where people usually getting older, having all kinds of different health issues, they cannot remember anymore. And at first, it's quite comical, but as things progress, it's not very comical anymore, because, you know, so sometimes at first they recognize you, your own family members, and as time goes on, they don't recognize you anymore. And you know, it is the frailty of the body in which we live. Sometimes those things happen. And every time I share this song, I am reminded that while we have memories that work real good, we should use them to its fullest. We will remember.
We will remember. We will remember the works of your hand.
And we will stop and give you praises for great is thy faithfulness.
Sing that again.
We will remember.
peace in the midst of the storm. With signs and wonders, you've shown your power. With precious blood, you showed us your grace. You've been our helper, our liberator, the giver of life with no end. We will remember, we will remember, we will remember the works of your hands, and we will stop and give you praise, for great is thy faithfulness. When we walk through life's darkest valley, we will look back at all you have done, and we will shout, our God is good, and He is a faithful one. Alleluia, alleluia, to the one to whom all blessings. Alleluia, alleluia, to the one whose glory has been shown. We will remember, we will remember, we will remember the works of your hand, and we will stop and give you sing this to you. I still remember the day you saved me, the day I heard you call out my name. You said you loved me, would never leave me,
and I'd never be
no.
The same.
Thy faithfulness.
For great is thy faithfulness.
For great is thy faithfulness.
For great is thy faithfulness.
Pastor Jason is going to speak more about this during the announcement time, and he's going to speak about our water baptism. Oh, it was so glorious, that water baptism last week. And I was telling Chris earlier on that in the whole history of the church, and we're pretty near 30 years, because we started in 1995, so in two more years we make 30 years. We never had anybody come out after being water baptized to any kind of Oli. We had that last week. That's the first time in all the history of the church. And it was all young people. And there's something, you know, you live in Hawaii, almost something medicinal. When you hear Olelo Hawaii, e ko ma ko ma ku I loko o kalane, e hono I a ko I no. Eh, hiki mai no au puni, eh, malama ia ko, make make matahou no ne. You don't even have to speak Hawaiian or know Hawaiian words. It does something to your spirit and to your soul.
Oh, Emakualani. Oh, you Kavaiola. Oh, you Eku.
Thank you, Lord. How to love and how to share. Greed and lust and vanity were mine, Lord. Then I found your love divine. Now on my knees I pray I'd find a way. Let me walk through paradise with you. My Savior, guide my feet along that lovely road. Oh, my Lord, let me follow in your footsteps as I walk through paradise with you. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please take the next few minutes to greet one another with the love of the Lord? Don't forget to say hi to the folks on the lanai, and don't forget to say hi to the folks that have tuned in on the virtual audience when Chris comes around with the iPad.
All right, good morning, New Hope Volcano. Good morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We've got some announcements for you this morning. What kind of t-shirt? Oh, where are they? At the desk in the back. Okay. Okay. Yes. Yes. All right. Amen. So before we get into the announcements, actually, you know, like Pastor Ray mentioned, our baptism this past Sunday, man, what a blessing, amen? Amen? What a beautiful day, what a great time of fellowship, and what an awesome blessing it was to witness people giving their lives to Christ, you know, expressing Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. It was such a special day. We do, if you're here earlier, we have a little presentation that we like to queue up for you. It's just some of the photos that were taken. I know a lot of you had taken photos as well, but our sister Chris, if you could cue up our presentation.
Hula does my mind.
All right, so what a blessing that was. And it was such a great experience. We're so thankful. There was even one woman who you saw in the slide. Her name was, I think, Amber. And she saw all the cars showing up. And she's like, what's going on? And then someone told her, it's a baptism. And she said, I want to be baptized. And so she came, and she sure did. She got baptized in the name of Jesus that day.
Hallelujah.
So part of being baptized here at New Hope Volcano, one awesome thing that Pastor Ray and Auntie Lani does, they put together a little certificate, and they frame it up for everyone. And ours still is hanging on our wall. It's one of a special, special moment. And so I'd like to call up everyone who did get baptized to just please come up here. We want to present you with a certificate, please. Yeah, Jen. Happy, brother. Rose, yes. How did you want to start? You want to start? Who do you want first? Sorry, you just want to. Okay. Yes, Fishers, please come up. All right, praise the Lord. So, Pastor Rhea, the first one is for, it's actually Lisa Sanchez. So, we'll present it to you guys for her.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Next. We have Jeannie. Oh, what a blessing, Jeannie. Thank you. God bless you. All right. We have Rose. Rose, congratulations. Okay. Auntie Mary. Woo-hoo. Love you, Auntie Mary. Love you. All right, the next one is for Jaren. Yes, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Okay, okay, next is Mama D. Mama D, there you go. What a blessing. And then we have our brother Happy. Yes, praise the Lord, Happy, praise the Lord. So if you guys can join me, let's lift our hands and pray for these people who, you know, publicly dedicated their life to Christ Jesus, or rededicated for some of them, if we can lift our hands. Father God, we thank you so much for the hearts that are here standing in front of this congregation this morning, Lord. We thank you for their hearts to want to be children of God, want to be followers of Christ Jesus. And we pray that you just bless them and fill them with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Lead them and guide them. We pray that you draw them near and make their path straight, Father. We thank you so much that we were witnesses to this day, that they gave their lives to Christ Jesus. Father, we thank you so much that we can stand shoulder to shoulder with them as children of God, and we welcome them into the kingdom, and we pray that their relationship with you will grow even bigger than it's ever been. Father, we love you so much. We give you all of the honor, the glory, and the praise, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, it was amazing because we did have a sign-up sheet, and we had a lot of people on the sign-up sheet, but there were more people that felt led by the Spirit to just be baptized that day. And so we have some here, and as you can see, we've got more to hand out for people who aren't here. But we did close to 20. I want to say maybe like 17. Okay, thank you, Chris. 17 we did that day. And it was just awesome. It was just amazing, amazing, amazing. So we have some announcements for you this morning. The first one is that we do have a few more of the 4th of July parade shirts left, and we have it on the back yes table. And if anybody would like it, and if it's your size, you can go ahead and take a look, and you can have a shirt that's on the back table. That's the first announcement. Thank you, Uncle Eddie. There you go. Beautiful. Baby blue. I'm about to call our sister Chris up for announcements, but I want to say, and Happy, I don't know, you can cut me off if we're getting too far into our workshop here. But, you know, we want to invite you to our Monday Love and Respect workshop. It's been an absolute blessing for everyone who's attended. I mean, we're learning new skills. We're learning what the Bible says. We're learning how to handle certain situations. And it is just amazing for married couples. And I can stand here today and share one amazing testimony with you guys this morning. And that is that yesterday, Stacy had women's ministry in the morning. And so when Stacy has women's ministry, I can pretty much count on her being in a good mood when it's finished. You know what I mean? I can almost count on it that when she walks out of the bedroom, she's in a good mood. Well, yesterday I needed to work on her car and change the tensioner pulley on her car. So I had to change two belts and a tensioner pulley. So I got started about 8 o'clock in the morning when she went into women's ministry. And then she came out of women's ministry and I'm just a mess, a filthy mess, grease everywhere. And she's like, "Do you need my help, babe?" And, you know, that's not my favorite thing to be asked, but I did need her help because I was struggling to get that pulley off. So she comes in and there was one nut on the pulley that just would not break off. And so I tried and I tried and I tried. I had used every tool that I had. I ran down to Ace Hardware. I bought new tools. I came back up. Stacy's helping me. She's a total mess. She's got grease like a baseball player under her eyes. She got grease in her hair. And we couldn't get it. I went down to Ace Hardware 3 times. And the last time I went and I bought a chisel. And so we started at 8 a.m. about 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock. We got that nut off. Yeah, yeah. And so my testimony is that we're still married. Because I don't know if you've experienced that before, but if you ever had to work with your spouse on something as frustrating as that, it can be difficult. It can be very straining on the relationship. But I gotta say, we handled it without a hitch. And so we even discussed that after it was done. We was like, "Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord." We did that without grumbling or arguing or getting mad or getting upset. And we finished it and we celebrated and we were so happy. And we owe it to Love and Respect Workshop. So if you want to join us, we are here. We start 5 p.m. sharp. You know, there's a video message that we watch for about 30 or 40 minutes. There's a workbook that we take home. We've got a little bit of homework. We can study a little bit. A lot of scriptures, a lot of testimony, a lot of advice to share. And it's just been a blessing. It's been a blessing. I think are we on week four already? And so if you want to join us, you're coming in a little bit late, but better than nothing, I would say. So you can join us Monday, which is tomorrow at 5 p.m. Amen. I feel sorry that you guys got to listen to that voice. That sounds horrible. Chris, if I can call you up, please, sister, for more announcements.
Good morning. It turns out that you can't really do YouTube Live and play a PowerPoint at the same time. Live and learn, right? That's what my mother always said. Okay, so Monday, people will be getting together to pray for you, and there's little prayer slips in the back if you want to fill one of those out or just write it down on a piece of paper or tell somebody because they would love to pray specifically for you. Monday night is also Love and Respect Workshop at 5 o'clock. Wednesday is Bible study here at 5 o'clock. Thursday is Hula here at 5 o'clock. Friday at 8 a.m., the super secret yard team will be here. Yes, join them. And then on Friday evening at 5:30 is Celebrate Recovery. Dinner at 5:30. Large group starts at 6. And I offered to give this book to anybody who wants to know your first step of Celebrate Recovery, but I'm going to just read you the very first paragraph. The Bible clearly states all have sinned. It is in my nature to sin and yours too. None of us is untainted because of sin. We've all hurt ourselves and other people, and others have hurt us. That means each of us needs recovery in order to live our lives the way God intended. So come join us. Check it out.
And guess what? Nobody will know.
Oh, yeah? Completely confidential and anonymous. On September 16th will be men's ministry at 9 a.m. It's always the third Saturday. Women's ministry is always the last Saturday, so the next one will be September 30th at 8 a.m. If you're looking for a place to serve, just ask us. We can fit you in somewhere because we certainly need some help in our all-volunteer army. We are also on Zoom and newhopevolcano.com, Facebook, and YouTube Live, and you can go on YouTube and watch videos all the way back to March 2020 if you want to go back in time and check out a lot of other things. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, sister. So yes, okay, youth group, if you guys are ready. All right. Yes, if you want to serve, you can let us know. There is a sheet that we have in the back where Uncle Eddie's sitting when you, if you want to give your tithe or your offering. And I'm not sure if Chris announced about the Monday prayer team, but you know, we have people here that want to pray for you. But if you do want to serve, you can just fill that sheet out, drop it into the offering bowl. One thing I do want to say about our church family, I just want to say that I can't express how blessed I feel to be a part of this New Hope Volcano Church family. It's such a blessing, and I am so amazed at how loving and how generous everybody is. And I say that because just I've experienced time and time again of this church just being so generous and so loving. Like Wednesday nights, it's starting to turn into a fiesta. Wednesday night, we gotta be careful because we have food. We have so much food. We're starting to get more people come. The fellowship is amazing. We get into the word. It's so great. If you want to join us, it's at 5 o'clock on Wednesday. We're in John chapter 14. Okay. Just checking if you guys was listening. 14. John chapter 14. Okay. So that being said, we're about to collect the tithes and the offerings. Like Chris said, we have a website, newhopevolcano.com. You can check it out for, you know, what's going on with the church, but also you can give online. There's a hamburger menu on the top right. You click on it, drop down menu will come down. You can click on give online, so you can give your tithe or your offering that way. If you're in the building and you want to give, we have the offering bowl in the back where Uncle Eddie's sitting. You can drop your tithe or your offering into the bowl. But we say all of that, of course, just to say if you are visiting us for the first time, please hold back on your money and just be blessed with what the Lord has in store for you this morning. If you're visiting us from another church, we ask that you too please hold back on your money and take it to your home church. And if this is your home church, we just ask that you please give with a cheerful heart. So if we could bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we humbly come before you this morning to give you thanks, to give you praises. And we thank you, Lord, for providing for us in every way, for knowing our hearts, for knowing our needs. Father, we know that our help comes from you. And your word says, you receive not because you ask not. And Lord, this morning we ask that you take our tithes and our offerings. We pray that you multiply it in abundance. But more importantly, we pray that you use it according to your will, Lord. Because we know that your way is the best way. And so, Father, we thank you for this church campus that you've provided for us. We thank you that we can come and worship together. We thank you for our brothers and sisters, our church family. We thank you for the message that's about to be shared with us from our brother Happy. And we pray that you speak through him and speak to our hearts. We thank you for your presence here. We thank you for this time that we can come and put you first, Lord. We set everything else aside and we just focus all of our attention, all of our heart on you. We love you so much, Lord. We give you all the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praise this morning. And we pray in Jesus' matchless name, as we all say, amen and amen. Please help me welcome this morning our brother Happy is going to share the word of God with us this morning. Thank you, brother.
Morning, everybody. There we go. Okay. Just a little visual eye check looking into your hearts here this morning. I gotta say, I am still so stoked from last Sunday's baptism. And somebody come up to me and said, you know, hey, like, you're getting baptized this morning? And it's like, yeah. And it's like, being a preacher and doing all this and that. And so the deal was that, okay, as I was preparing this morning's sermon, actually I thought I was going to give it last Sunday, okay, I'm in my prayer time and it dawned on me, I could not remember for the life of me being baptized, which was astonishing to me because of what a prominent component, you know, that baptism has been for me. I've engaged in lots of baptisms and things. So, you know, I'm sitting there in my prayer and meditation time, okay, and all of a sudden I get this like message, hey bub, they're doing a baptism Sunday, okay. It was on my heart to do this, and I've just been so blessed, especially to participate in that baptism with the people that I share that time with. And it really is all about participating in the family that God gives us. Our message this morning is titled, Are We Disciples Making Disciples? Because that's really what we're all about here. So why a sermon on discipleship? Well, way back, you know, a couple months ago, I guess it's not all way back, but if you can remember, we did a sermon, okay, and a teaching on the effectual calling, where we acknowledge that each of us who have been called have been predestined to serve our Father according to His will, and that He had a specific plan for our lives. We came to believe that if we had been called, we must also be saved. And if saved, we had
just as Jesus washed the feet of his disciples the night before he went to the cross, he gave us the example of loving service and disciplining one another by washing his disciples' feet. Okay. The word tells us that one of the main reasons for our existence and why we have been called and saved is so that we too can serve and disciple our brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, just as our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ did and continues to do for us. Therefore, he commissioned us to make disciples and to pick up where he left off on his earthly ministry so that the gospel could be preached throughout the world. What I want to experience today, and prayed the Holy Spirit for, is that we can gain a deeper understanding and awareness of the Great Commission. To be able to provide a greater and
experience a greater awareness of the who, what, when, where, and hows, that we mature believers are to disciple new believers so that they are brought to Christ, so that those that brought to Christ can spiritually mature and go out and make other disciples. It's a ripple effect that we have on one another. So God is calling us to be disciple-making disciples. You know, one of the saddest things that Sandy and I have experienced, you know, at different churches, the bottom line is that we've been in a church where the spiritual growth among the body just ceased to become. Body was much older and hardly any young folks there, which is a telltale sign that something's missing. Okay? Because it's our young folks and the new folks coming to Christ that are going to be the next link, okay, and are discipling others. So we really need to be there. But, you know, it was like everybody would show up Sunday to get their ticket punched as far as, well, I went to church. And, of course, everybody wanted to stay for the potluck and fellowship after the service. But no one was truly taking the time or the energy or effort to disciple one another and to help one another grow up in Christ. It's like they have this thing of, well, I got mine, or I did my time, just as if they have all retired, okay, from being in, of service to one another and being engaged in ministry. Folks, here's the deal. If maturity is not emphasized, if spiritual growth is being marginalized, if we become satisfied with how many folks are in the seats, regardless of their spiritual age and condition, we have failed as a church and as a ministry, both locally and as the body of believers in Christ. You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's what we're here for. To learn, to grow, to mature, and to help one another be lifted up. Okay. But keep in mind, the Sunday service, okay, it's just what Paul referred to as the milk. Okay. As the milk. Okay. In the sense that the milk basically can be considered everything that Jesus said and done, that we can experience through reading, learning, witness, fellowship, okay, is the milk. Okay. But what Paul is coming and wanting us to do, and what the Great Commission is commanding us to do, is to become spiritually mature Christians. Okay. So that's our goal. Let's go ahead and pray. Father God, we thank you for this moment in time, Lord, that you have given us, Lord, to hear your word and reflect on your commandment, your commission, and the principles in your word that you have given us to consider. Lord, we want to honor you and bring you all the glory. And we thank you that you've given us this opportunity to pick up where you left off, and informing the disciples and us what we're to do to perpetuate your church and to carry your saving grace throughout the world. Father, we pray that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear. Father, we would pray that you would open up our hearts and allow the experience to flow. And Father, we want to glorify you and give you all the honor and praise and glory for who you are and the plan for our lives that you have given us. And everybody said, so the Great Commission we know of is in Matthew 28 and verses 28 and 29. It says, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Now, first of all, as I was preparing this, okay, I wanted to understand, how is it we discern between what a command of God is versus a principle that he has given us to live by? Anybody wrestle with that question? Is this a command? This is a principle. What makes something, you know, a command from the word? And, you know, what's the difference? So, you know, looking up the definition in the Strong's book, okay, command is defined as to give orders, such as injunctions, instructions, commands. Okay. So to differentiate between the Bible principles of God's commandments, we first must ask ourselves a couple questions. Question one, is God asking me to do something specific here? If so, what is he asking me to do? Or asking ourselves, is God asking me not to do something here? Okay, something specific, okay, here. And if so, what is he asking me not to do? So if the answer to either question is a definite yes, you're looking at a commandment. Make sense? I hope. Okay. For example, okay, go and make disciples of all nations. Is God asking us to do something specific here? Yes, he is. He's asking us to make disciples. So the conclusion here is, it's a commandment. Okay. Another example would be like from 2 Corinthians 6:14 that says, do not be yoked with unbelievers. Is God specifically asking us not to be yoked with an unbeliever? No. Okay. Bottom line, most of us don't even have a yoke, and if we did, we'd never be tempted to literally get yoked with an unbeliever. Okay. So what we need to come to understand is this is a principle. And basically, God's principles allow us the opportunity where we got to decide, okay, how to apply them to our life. Whereas God's commands are very black and white, very cut and dry, okay? No question about it, okay? Another way to, you know, check it out is to read Proverbs, the book of Proverbs. Proverbs is almost 100% principles and very few commands. Whereas the book of Leviticus is almost 100% commands, but very few principles. So it's a good way to help you discern and get a feel for what a command is versus what a principle is. When looking at the Great Commission, we can determine that the only specific action that Jesus is commanding us is to make disciples. Because when taking the time to consider the sentence structure of the Great Commission, we see that the words go, baptize, and teach, those words are all passive participles of the verb make, thereby describing ways we are to utilize them while we're making disciples. Go is not a command. Teach is not a command. Baptize is not a command. So in practical application, it could be better translated as you're going, make disciples. As you're baptizing, make disciples. As you're teaching, make disciples. So why does Jesus place such great importance in making disciples? Well, the Great Commission is a charge to proclaim the gospel, which involves preaching the good news, witnessing from a personal experience and relationship with God, effectively loving one's neighbor by the power of the Holy Spirit, and journeying through the process of discipleship and growth so as to become a co-laborer in ministry and the church. Jesus' authority in heaven and on earth is a global authority. The commissioning of Jesus' disciples to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all things that Jesus has commanded them, is a call to a global mission. It's a call to a global mission. If you think about it, also, making disciples is our Lord's means for answering what has come to be known as the Lord's Prayer. You know the one? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we see that in Matthew 6, verses 9 and 10. You know, in his infinite wisdom, Jesus chose to use dedicated followers, his disciples, to carry the message of salvation to all peoples of the world. It therefore makes sense that he included making disciples as his last command and his last words to disciples, his disciples, before he ascended on high. Making disciples is important because it is the Lord's chosen method of spreading the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ. During his public ministry, Jesus spent more than 3 years making disciples, teaching and training his chosen 12. He gave them many convincing proofs that he was the Son of God, the promised Messiah, and they believed him, however imperfectly that might have been. You know, he spoke to crowds, we know, okay, but often he drew his disciples aside privately to teach them the meaning of his parables and miracles, okay? And I'm saying these things all as examples of ways that we can get involved in being there and growing others up, okay? As we know, Jesus sent them out on ministry assignments. He also taught them that he soon would be leaving and returning to his Father following his death and resurrection. Though they could not comprehend it, he made the disciples this astonishing promise in John 14:12. I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And the last time, you know, a couple times ago, maybe, we talked about why Jesus going to the Father was so important. And the reality was Jesus had to go be with his Father so he could be mediator, okay, for what was happening on earth. But he left the Holy Spirit to remind us and tell us and remind us everything that Jesus had told us. Everything. How many of you sit in prayer and are talking with God, and all of a sudden a scripture verse will pop into your head? Let's see. Come on now. Okay. If that's never happened, you are really missing out. Okay. There'll be a prayer class to follow. Okay. Jesus also promised to send his Holy Spirit to be with them forever. We see in John 14. So as promised, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came with power on the believers, who then were emboldened to speak the good news of salvation to everyone. No more fears. No more fears. The remainder of the book of Acts is wonderful because it gives the exciting account of all that was accomplished through the disciples as they would grow others up. You know, it said in Acts 17, that really stood out to me, okay? It said that in one city, quote, those who have turned the world upside down have come here also. Are we turning the world upside down? Multitudes placed their faith in Jesus Christ, and they also became disciples. When strong persecution came from false religious leaders, they dispersed to other areas and continued to obey Christ's commands, and churches were established throughout the Roman Empire and eventually the whole world. So what's a disciple? Keeping it simple, a disciple is one who has been baptized, given a new identity. We experienced that last Sunday, a new identity when we were raised up out of the water, and is now willing to take upon him or her the name of the Savior and follow him. A disciple strives to become as Jesus by keeping his commandments, much the same way as an apprentice seeks to become like his or her master or boss. Taking a look, there are like three key characteristics of being a disciple. Number one is we follow Jesus. We follow Jesus. And we see in Luke 9:23, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny to themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. So we're learning how to get out of self and develop our spiritual eyes and learn how to look at everyone, people, places, and things through God's eyes and how he would see him. Not as how our selfish, self-centered person would see them. Number two, we're being changed by Jesus. And that's so important that we change. Okay. Pastor Jason's, you know, favorite scripture is from Romans 12:1 and 12:2. Which basically boils down to, you know, we got to have a new mind. And Jesus gives us that new mind, that new way about thinking about things. And if our beliefs, attitudes, and expectations, the way we think about things change in a biblical perspective, our feelings are then going to also be impacted. And we're going to be experienced much more prone to experience the joy and the wonderment and the thanksgiving and the gratitude that comes from being aware
of what the Lord our God is working us and taking us to in our life. Okay. Once we have those feelings, okay, they're not going to control us, okay, to do all those selfish things anymore, because they're going to be feelings of God's joy, peace, and harmony, okay, where we're not going to have to respond the old way that we did before those of us that were baptized were submersed and washed away with. Thirdly, he or she is committed to their sanctification and the mission of Jesus. Committed. In 1 Peter 4, verse 19, it says, so if you are suffering in a manner that pleases God, keep on doing what is right and trust your lives to the God who created you, for he will never fail you. You know, I often put in my weekly morning texts, okay, how I put things in perspective for myself, in the sense that, and what that basically says is that we are placed and created to be placed on God's highway to heaven. Yeah? Okay. He has given us Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, as a traveling partner to help guide us and direct us through his Holy Spirit, okay, that really is the road map for this highway we're on. Man, can you think of any better place to be? We are his. And as long as we surrender our will and our self, he promises us that he's going to get us to where he created us to go. The life in heaven, in his glory, for eternity. Man. You know, Paul complains to the church at Corinth. In 1 Corinthians 3, verses 1 through 3. And he says to him, and I, brethren, could not speak to you as spiritual people, but as to carnal, as to babes in Christ. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you were not able to receive it. Even now you're still not able, for you are still carnal, which means fleshly. You know, for some people, they may have gotten saved early on in their lives, or they just, you know, got involved with attending church with their friends as just a way of life for them. Mm-hmm. They got used to the routine of going to church. It's like they'd go to church on Sundays or holidays, go to a youth group or small group on Tuesday or Wednesdays. But for many, that's all they learned how to do. No one taught them the Christian disciplines. No one sat down with them and showed them and taught them how to grow in their faith. The journey into our spiritual maturity. You know, it was neat because last week when we were doing the fellowship after service, the TV monitors were still on and scrolling through the things. And I saw our mission statement here at New Hope Church. It says, we exist to present the gospel of Jesus Christ in such a way that turns non-Christians
into converts into disciples, and disciples into mature, fruitful leaders who will in turn go into the world and reach others for Christ. Honestly, who knew and was aware of what the mission of New Hope Church here was? Who knew? Okay. I don't know. I'm still employed, okay? But the best thing I got going for me is that my employer makes very clear what our mission statement is. Without it, we'd be lost. And the same thing here for the Great Commission. So when we take a look at the spiritual growth, okay, and basically this is where you can look at your diagrams there, okay. You'll see in the center row, okay, or in the center of the page, the path of spiritual growth. It's basically start off with the spiritually dead. We become spiritual children. We become spiritual disciples. We become disciple makers. And we become spiritual or collaborators in ministry. That's the path. Okay. Now notice the path, although it's always going forward, okay, there's some peaks and valleys in there. And basically that's letting us know that some of us are going to excel in some areas of our sanctification, and others, we may hit a stall point and need more time and help from others to walk through. So we notice that the path goes up and sometimes plateaus, okay? The words on the bottom of the page, or on a diagram, name the task of the discipler, that one giving the help to that new person. The words at the top name the tasks of the disciplee, those being discipled to. Notice that there's numbers. The numbers on the left of the diagram are the numbers representing the discipler's responsibility. Part on the left starts at a 10, yeah? A lot of time and energy and effort, okay, going into to that new believer. The numbers on the right, again, are the disciplee's responsibility. Notice that it starts off with a low number, and as they're discipled, their responsibility increases. So bottom line, though, if no one takes the time to walk the disciples through the maturing process, they end up simply living the day by day and risk becoming stagnant, just as carnal or fleshly Christians end up. Okay. You know, I spent many years in the Fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous once I surrendered and gave my life to Christ, okay, because of the addiction issues I was facing. You know, I spent many years there, okay, and in my years of service as a sponsor, I always was aware of those newcomers that were new to recovery that would always try to do things on their own. Many times they would attempt to work the first three steps on their own, then experience the positive consequences of just being sober and be content with that. Oh, this is different. Okay. I woke up this morning rather than came to. All right. So there's lots of natural things that happen just not drinking anymore. Okay, but what always would amaze me is that they would stop after those first three steps. You know, yes, step one, yes, they admitted they were powerless in regards to that their addiction. You know, step two, yes, they came to believe that God could and would restore them to sanity if they were sought. And step three, yes, they would even tell themselves that they made a decision to turn their will and lives over to the care of God. But what's interesting, as soon as the novelty of just being sober subsided, then, you know, their life began to kind of fall apart. Okay. And then they wondered why they continued to be just as miserable in their abstinence as they were when they were drinking. Excuse me. But my shock, you know, shocking presentation, you know, trying to get their attention, and it's like, well, why don't you just go back out drinking? Okay. Why be more miserable in your sobriety without any tools or survival skills, okay, to ease that pain, just to say, I'm not drinking anymore. I don't know. Bottom line, there was no future or no further growth or maturity happening in their lives, and they were miserable every step of the way, many times leading them back to jails, institutions, and death. We see in 1 Corinthians, again, chapter 3, verses 1 through 3, Paul states to the church at Corinth, "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as spiritual people, but as to cardinal, as to babes in Christ. I fed you with milk, not with solid food, for now you were not able to receive it, and even now you're still not able, for you're still carnal," which we had read before. So let me put this in context for a moment. Paul first went to teach and preach to the people in Corinth somewhere around 50 AD. Paul is writing this letter to those now at the church of Corinth in 55 AD. That's 5 years. That's 5 years. So basically, I suspect Paul is taking exception to the fact that in 5 years, many believers at the church in Corinth have not as yet become spiritually mature believers. Taking it a step further, if you'd look at Hebrews chapter 5, starting at verse 12, keeping in mind that the book of Hebrews was written some 30 years after the Lord had died, was buried, and was resurrected. This would mean that there were also believers there that had been saved for 30 years. So he gives the bookend examples of, by 5 years, okay, you ought to have become mature. And at 30 years, you should be spiritually mature. But he goes on to say, "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God. And you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of the milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness," meaning that They had not put those things into practice. Okay. But solid food belongs to those who are full age. That is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. You know what the writer is saying here? They're past just the milk, okay? The milk is what leads us to the meat of God's word. You know where we experience the meat of God's word? We experience the meat when we meet on Mondays to come pray for everybody that typically sits in a common chair, as well as any other prayer requests that might be in that box. The meat comes on Wednesday nights when we come not just to read the book of the gospel or wherever we may be, but to dissect it, to chew on it, to discuss it. I've learned so much in the small group Bible studies. And the fact is, it's really surpassing being a small group. Now, Pastor Jason? Mm-hmm. But it's where we come to get real food, solid food. Thursday, and just coming to participate in Hula. When you're watching the dancers up here, is there any doubt that they are glorifying God? It's so beautiful to see. And again, how it opens up those that see it, okay, heart to become even more aware of what the Spirit's doing and joining us together. Fridays, celebrate recovery. Okay. And I could go on forever about the blessing of celebrate recovery and the meat that there is. You see, for those folks that have struggled with those self-defeating behaviors and thoughts and feelings, they get to experience truth. And not truth that is preached at them, but truth that they come through gaining by the word of God and the steps and principles set down in that program. You know, Friday mornings, okay? We got the work crews out here, you know? I got to tell you, on Sundays, okay, I'm very aware of all the servants that are at work taking care of cleaning this place up as we are enjoying fellowship with one another. And the Friday morning gig where they're working, demonstrating their gifts, you know, to enhance the environment that we get to experience here is awesome. Okay. It says that they have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. That's what we need to experience, to know. The word of righteousness is really, okay, it embodies the thought of God's justice and righteousness in his dispensation and governmental dealings with his people. Righteousness is being right with people, places, and things and other matters before God according to his righteousness and strict requirements. So the difference between being spiritual and being a carnal Christian, they both differ regarding their involvement and methods of functioning. Carnality solely involves the desire for worldly lusts of flesh and physical relationships, pleasure. Okay. While just the opposite of true is spiritual maturity, which is far more concerned with the human spirit or soul and how God sees everything and wants us to see everything. People are carnal when they yield to their worldly flesh urges. And yes, carnal Christians are saved and on their way to heaven. But they are following their own fleshly nature at that moment more than the Holy Spirit. So we have got to be there to go, Happy, are you aware of how this is coming across? I don't think it's a very good example. Okay. Because iron sharpens iron. That's why the men's Bible study is such an asset and so incredible. Brothers, I have come to love you so intensely that participate in the men's group on Sunday or on the third Saturday of every month. Okay? Because it helps. In Colossians 1, 28 and 29, it says, He is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. To this end, I strenuously labor with all the energy Christ so powerfully works in me. That's where Paul's energy is. That's where he labors into making everyone and presenting so that everyone could be presented, to God the Father at some level of spiritual maturity. So really, when you think about it, we see how our mission statement here at New Hope Church is the same mission statement that Paul gives first Colossians, to present everyone as spiritually mature in Christ. That's our goal. Again, that's what we're here for. Spiritual maturity is defined basically as a mature Christian whose whole character, dispositions, words, and actions emulates the character of Jesus Christ himself. It is that process of maturation that brings us into spiritual maturity and grows us in our sanctification. Finally, the indicative statement that introduces this great commission that we've been talking about says, All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. It alerts us to the reality that Jesus is not only a teacher, he is our Lord. He's our Lord. This reinforces the conclusion that the pattern of disciple making is not to be a human relationship, but one that faithfully points to Jesus Christ at all times. Okay. In other words, we do not make disciples that follow us, but rather, with God's grace and help, we make disciples that follow him. Yeah? Discipleship, it's an amazing cycle. As we're growing, as you are growing yourself, you are also growing others. And what a blessing that is to participate in. The opposite happens as well. When we are growing someone else, we end up growing as well. That's why it's a relationship, and it needs to be relationship. You know, how many of you were present last Sunday to witness the baptisms going on? Okay. I'm here to tell you that you are now charged with a new responsibility. And that is to be there for them people that you observed and witnessed getting baptized. You know, we can't do this on our own. You know, we can read the Bible all day long. We can go to every group, small group, that there is. We can get involved in everything that there is to get involved with. But if we don't do it with the right heart, based on what the Holy Spirit is prompting us to do, for the glory of God, we're not going to gain any spiritual maturity at all, because we're not experiencing the meat, the solid food. It's my prayer that we get even closer. Because as disciples, we got to develop relationships with one another. I love sometimes sitting out, you know, on the lanai as we eat and hearing people share parts of their testimony and their life. How many of you know specifically someone in this church body that you know exactly what to pray for them? Okay. That's what we got to be digging into. Okay. And on the other hand, we got to let people in this church know, hey, I am really hurting. And I feel like I have been walking in the wilderness all by myself without God's direction for a week or two or a month or longer. We need to have those mentors in our life. Moses was to Aaron. Solomon was to Elijah. Okay. How Barnabas was to Paul. How Paul was to Timothy. How, my thinking of names is crazy. Okay. How Philip was placed on the road that he was placed on, which was a detour as far as his thinking, just so he could meet up with the Ethiopian eunuch that was reading the word of Isaiah, so that he could help that eunuch come to an understanding of Jesus Christ and what was happening at that moment in time in that country that they were in. So much so, it got him so excited that as they drove along, the first chance he got when they saw some water, he goes, "There's some water. Okay. I want to be baptized. I want to make a confession of my faith," just like we did Sunday. Be here. Be present. Not just sit here and get our tickets punched, or to be entertained, but be here to glorify God. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you so much, Lord, for the teaching that you placed on my heart this morning, and we would pray that we could take this home and chew on it, and evaluate where we are in that discipleship process flow chart. What do we need? Okay. Have we become disciples? And constantly asking ourselves, what can I do for that person to make a difference and bring them closer to you? That's what we want, Lord, to be more like Jesus and emulate him in every way. So for those of you that have not come to Christ, okay, you're not even spiritual babes yet. Okay? You're what the word calls natural man. You cannot discern the things from this book, okay, and teaching until you open your heart and allow the Holy Spirit to come flooding in and call you to salvation, to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And for those of you that are still in the natural man, not knowing how to discern the word of God, okay, come and let one of us know. And come and let us open and help open the door for you so that Christ can be working in your life. Father God, we thank you for all things. Everything is going to your glory. We thank you for the love that you allow us to experience with one another here. And thank you, Lord, for the food that you provided we're going to chow down on, Lord, and we pray your blessings upon it, that it would go to our good health and nourishment. And everybody said, amen. Amen.
Thank you, Happy. I want to applaud that word. Thank you, Lord. Ladies and gentlemen, that marks the formal conclusion of our Sunday service. We're going to sing one more song. If you feel like singing, then please sing with us. If you're ready for refreshments, you've already been blessed by the best. Hello. And so you can make your way to the lanai. I think the refreshments table is ready to go. If you're heading out to enjoy the rest of the day, and it is a beautiful day, not as beautiful as it was last week Sunday down at the beach, but pretty close.
Amen.
Please be reminded when you get to Highway 11, look both ways as cars come up and down pretty quickly. Whatever you decide to do, God bless you, everybody, and have a great rest of the day.
One quick announcement before we go. Friday night, celebrate recovery. Live testimony. Mine. Come check it out.
All right.
All heaven declare the beauty of the risen Lord. Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever he will be,
forever he will be,
the Lamb upon the throne,
the Lamb upon the throne.
I gladly bow my knee,
I gladly bow my knee,
and worship you alone. God bless you, everybody.